What about Michael Levin's bioelectric fields?
Well, that's a field theory of memory. But you see, his bioelectric field, Levin's theory of memory is rather ambiguous, because Levin did those wonderful experiments with flatworms. You may remember them. He trained them to respond to particular light and respond in particular ways. He trained them behaviorally in a distinctive way. And he then cut off their heads, which contain their rather minimal brain. And then because they regenerate very easily, they grew new heads. And when they grow new heads, they remembered what they'd learned before. So my hypothesis would be that this was because of morphic resonance. They were resonating with themselves in the past. The memory was transmitted across space and time. That's what morphic resonance does. It's about transmitting memories across space and time based on similarity. But Levin, in his published paper on this, said, well, maybe there must be material memories stored all through the body, and it somehow managed to retrieve them from cellular memories in different parts of the worm. Possible. But he didn't think it was a biofield that was responsible for the memory when he did that research. And if it was a biofield, an electric field, then the electric field would have been tremendously disturbed by cutting the head off. So it wasn't as if it would have been an intact biofield. Then you'd have the problem, how on earth could an electric field of the whole worm retain a memory when you disrupted the field so severely by chopping the head off the worm? And as far as I know, Levin's not suggesting that the memories are carried in these electric biofields.
Do you see yourself as being congruent with Michael Levin's bioelectric field, with his work? That is, that perhaps you have the same point of view, but you just give different mechanisms? Or do you believe that you have different points of view on the same mechanism?
Oh, there's a lot of overlap between me and Levin. I greatly admire and like his work. I think he's one of the most creative biologists working today, and also one of those who keeps alive a holistic approach in biology as opposed to molecular biological reductionism, you know, trying to reduce everything to molecules and genes and things. So it's holistic, and he and I are both very interested in the idea of morphogenetic fields, form-shaping fields that shape developing organisms. He has, as I do, a kind of top-down approach to development. It's not just lots of molecules interacting that somehow allow cells to emerge and cells interacting that allow tissues to emerge bottom-up. There's an overall plan or shape of the whole organism, that a field which works top-down. Fields work top-down. You know, a magnetic field works on the whole magnet and all around the magnet, top down, and if you put iron filings there, you can reveal the field. But it doesn't come into being through individual iron filings that have been lined up, creating the magnetic field. The magnetic field's there and acts in a top down way. The gravitational field acts in a top down way. So the fields, that's how fields work, electrical and magnetic fields, and all fields. So he thinks that the organism's shaped by fields, and so do I. Then the question is, how are these fields inherited? How does the field of a past organism influence the present one? How is the field when a cat is developing a cat embryo? Where does that field come from? And both he and I agree it can't come from the genes, because the genes are the same in all cells, and they just program the development of proteins. They're not shaping paws and noses and whiskers and things in the developing kitten. So he thinks the fields work through bioelectricity, that they work through bioelectric fields, and so do I. Where we differ is how they're inherited. I think they're inherited by morphic resonance, non-materially, by this influence across space and time from the past. And I don't think he knows how they're inherited. And if he thinks it happens by morphic resonance, he doesn't say so. And it's utterly mysterious as how these fields could work in the Levin scheme of things. I rather suspect that if morphic resonance were proved and accepted scientifically, rather than being treated as a kind of heresy, that Levin would probably rather like that. And I think it would enable him to understand a lot of his own experiments in a new way. But there's no reason why Levin should adopt morphic resonance at the moment when it's still a speculative theory.
I thought when I was speaking with Levin and I was hearing him talk about his philosophy that he was an idealist, but I've come to the understanding, and I could be misunderstanding, that he's a physicalist. It's just he's more on the Mysterian end of the physicalism, which says that it is all physics or physical or material or what have you. It's just that we don't have a handle on what that material is.
Yes. Well, you see, I think morphogenetic fields are physical. I mean, they're not part of existing physics. And I'd agree with Levin about that, that I think morphogenetic fields are physical in the sense that they shape physical processes and interact with electromagnetic fields. And I think morphic resonance is physical. It's a process. I think it works in molecules and crystals. I think they have collective memories as well as biological species. And I think morphic resonance underlies a lot of actual physical processes. So I'm not saying it's supernatural or something. I'm saying it's part of an expanded physics. Mm-hmm. We have a very limited physics at the moment. But you could expand physics. Morphic resonance doesn't have to be conscious. In fact, it's a theory of habit. What it says is that in the most general sense, that the so-called laws of nature are not eternal laws fixed for all time at the moment of the Big Bang. They're actually evolving habits. And habits are unconscious, even in us. So it doesn't require consciousness, morphic resonance, but it does require habit and memory. So I agree with Levin, you see, that there's physics that we don't yet know and would actually transform physics itself. Now that leaves the question of consciousness is at another level. You have to move up a level to get to consciousness and what's going on there. But for biological development, habits and morphogenetic fields and morphic resonance would expand our physical terms of explanation while remaining in a kind of expanded version of physicalism. It doesn't require abandoning physicalism per se. It just requires expanding physics. So I think he and I would probably agree that that's something that could happen.
Huge update. I just launched a Substack a few weeks ago. It was somehow awarded the 2024 Featured Publication Award. If you enjoy these videos, remember that they're usually available several days or even weeks ahead of time on my Substack. Click the link in the description to head over there now and subscribe. The writings there are currently about language, ill-defined concepts, the behind the scenes of the highs and lows of meeting Roger Penrose. That one went semi-viral, by the way, as well as some of the other mathematical details. There's much more being written there. It's content that isn't available anywhere else. It's not even on Theories of Everything, the YouTube channel. It's not on Patreon. Also, full transcripts will be placed there at some point in the future. Several people say to me, hey, Curt, you've spoken to so many people in the fields of theoretical physics and philosophy and consciousness. What are your thoughts? Now, while I remain impartial during the interviews, this Substack is a way to peer into my present deliberations on these topics. Head over to curtjaimungal.substack.com and subscribe.